Welcome back, everybody, to the Jacksonville Jaguars franchise here on Madden 21. Today, we conclude the regular season here of Week 17 against the Indianapolis Colts. Before we talk about today's episode at hand, I do want to talk about the future of the series. Of course, with Madden 22 on the horizon, this series will be nearing a close within the coming weeks. The plan was always to get through six seasons, and I still want to do one more season after this one, but I don't know if I'm going to have enough time because we have to get through a playoff run, an offseason, a whole nother season, possibly another playoff run, and you get the point. I don't think I'm going to be able to do it in 3-4 weeks. So I just want to hear what you think in the comments below. Let me know how I should go about the future of the series before Madden 22 comes out. All right, let's talk about Week 17 now. Last episode, we played two games and won both of them. We had a big win over the Bills 38-30 in a very important game for AFC seeding, and we clinched the one seed by beating the Bears in the snow 38-24. So as I said, we've clinched the playoffs, we've clinched the division, we've clinched the top seed in the conference. So on paper, this game does not look very important, but I don't quite think that is the case. We're playing the Indianapolis Colts, who are 8-7. There are a lot of 8-7 teams in the AFC fighting for playoff spots. So this is a major game for the Colts, and we can play spoiler for our division rivals. Miles Jack has been cleared by the doctors. There's no reason to bring him back in since we are the one seed. I do plan on starting most of the starters except at quarterback. I want Marsusio Alteron to get another opportunity. He has not played since Coco got hurt earlier in the year. Other than that, we're going to be starting all of our healthy starters, and as the game goes on, I do plan on putting in some backups. I want to spoil the Indianapolis Colts from a playoff spot because, to be honest, I don't really want to face the Colts in the playoffs. I think they're a tough team. They nearly beat us in the postseason last year. But at the same time, we also have to avoid our key players getting injured. So we're going to have to manage that strongly as we get this one underway. Week 17 action, the 8-7 Colts fighting for a wild card spot, taking on the 12-3 Jaguars, looking for one final tune-up before the playoffs. Bad throw by Marsusio Alteron, incomplete. He tried to get it to Zeke Bowman. And here is our first look at Rodney Allen in the Colts offense. He hands it off for Marlon Mack, who gets stuffed behind the backfield by Ke'Lavon Chaisson, who, of course, is needing a contract extension this offseason. Has he warranted a big payday, especially if the Jaguars giving Josh Allen a lot of money last year? 3rd and 6, Mack is stopped again, losing 3 on the screen. A great play by the young linebacker, David Harris. That'll force a punt. Westlake gets it back. Isaiah Sparks with the rock. Sparks with a nice cut. Down the field, he gets it inside the 35. Don't expect a busy day from Isaiah Sparks. He'll get some touches, but expect RJ Ewell to be the main ball carrier for Jacksonville today. Speaking of Ewell, he gets the ball here from the 32. Ewell with a nice run, a possibly touchdown-saving tackle by Malik Hooker, but still a good gain of 16 as Darren Lee, the veteran linebacker, is hurt on the play. 1st and goal now, RJ Ewell with the handoff, cuts by Hooker and is in for a Jacksonville touchdown. Now DeForest Buckner is hurt. The Colts are getting slammed by the injury bug early in this game as it is a 7-0 Jaguar lead. Colts with it. 1st down, Rodney Allen. His pass is intercepted. A great play by the young corner, Bob Adams, who brings it all the way to the 27. Adams has shown a ton of strides this year. He's really improved his game throughout the season, back-to-back weeks with an interception, and through the first half of the year, I viewed him as a liability. Now I view Bob Adams as a strength in this defense. 1st and goal, Sparks into the end zone for a touchdown. That is rushing score number 14 on the season for the explosive rookie Isaiah Sparks, who, of course, did have his dev trait revealed last episode, and as you can probably tell, it is superstar X-Factor. Colts with it. Marlon Mack, it's been a rough day for him. He loses 5 there. Again, it's David Harris who brings him down. And Jacksonville's defense, who's looked really shaky the past few weeks, is currently on fire to start this game off. 3rd down and 10 now for Indianapolis. Rodney Allen looking to throw it. It's another screen. The screens are not working today. And he almost got the first. What a tackle by Rashawn Babineau. I think if Marlon Mack just kept running and didn't do that little juke move, he probably could have gotten it. But still, a great tackle by Babineau, and the Jaguars get it back. Third and six, Marsusio up the middle for DJ Chark. He had a few receivers wide open on that play. Chark going backwards. He brings it to the 44, and that'll do it for the first quarter. The Jaguars looking really impressive so far. They lead 14-0. The Jags are not going to play for two full weeks since they are getting a first-round bye, so I think it is good to have the players not overly rusty. Third and 11, the pass for Sparks is dropped. There is a holding call on the play. If I was Indianapolis, I would accept this call because if Jacksonville can kick a field goal, they can make it a three-score game. I understand it would still be third down if they accept it, but that's what I would have done. Indy clearly disagrees. Volker Gantz makes the kick. And as I said, I believe that's a mistake. If you could have gotten a stop, Marsusio has not been overly accurate today. They could have easily forced a punt and gotten the ball back only down by 14. So Indy gets it back down 17. Look at Marlon Mack go. He's had a rough day so far, but he now gets a big play here all the way to the 27-yard line, tracked out of bounds by Isaiah Clemmings. And it seems like the Colts offense is finally deciding to show up. Could it be too little too late? I don't know. There's still plenty of time left in this game. Third and four, the veteran T.Y. Hilton in motion. Rodney Allen, the $177 million man. Yeah, he got paid earlier in the season. Gets it to the tight end, Jordan Reed, who brings it to the two. And Indy is very close, just inching their way towards the end zone. Second and goal now from the one. Colts trying to punch it in. Rodney Allen under pressure. He is sacked by the big defensive tackle, Bleet Friarwood, the Manitoba Canada native with the play. Now it's third and goal from the four. Allen again drops back to pass, looking to throw it. He is intercepted in the end zone by Zaire Wiggins, and he might take this one the distance. A 100-yard pick six for the best cornerback of the National Football League. There I said it. Wiggins up to 5 interceptions this season after recording 12 last year. And at this point, the starters on defense have shown enough. This defense looks absolutely incredible. They're ready for the playoffs. They've shown that they're all good. So that means a lot of the backups are going to come in. A lot of young, intriguing guys here getting an opportunity. Look at Sean Harris and Ford Carlson at both safety spots. On the defensive line, you got guys like Cephas Bornang, Horton Kowalski, and Kari Allison. So we'll get to see a lot of young guys really get an opportunity. Nice grab there by Jordan Reed. Colts inching closer to the end zone as they now have it at the 8 with an opportunity to finally get on the board. Allen connects with Cassius Jacobs Miller for the touchdown. For Carlson, the fourth-round pick out of Virginia Tech, unable to play the ball there. If that was one of Jacksonville's starting defensive backs, that might have been an interception. So it is now 24-7. Marsusio, for whatever reason, just runs into Tack McKinley. That is an easy sack for the Colts. A rare bad play by the standout left tackle, Bentley Vonderwalson. Only 23 seconds left in the first half. Indy trying to get some last-second points as Jordan Reed with a nice move to the 36-yard line. Colts going to go for a long field goal now, down to 4 seconds. This is a 53-yarder, far from a guarantee. And that is no good. It did not have the distance, and it was wide left. So that'll do it for the first half. And for a team who needs to win in order to make the playoffs, the Colts do not look very impressive at all up to this point. The Jaguars are looking strong on both sides of the ball. The starting defense was great. The offense has been not phenomenal, but they've been good enough. On to the second half, Indianapolis starting with the rock. We'll see if the Colts can do some damage control here in the third. Rodney Allen gets it to the second-year standout, Dale McBride. And it's been a lot of fun seeing a lot of these young Westlake players develop in the NFL. But there aren't many who have been more impressive than Dale McBride. He's only 22 years old, and he has just turned out to be a star. Allen's pass is tipped and intercepted by Daquan McBride. No relations to Dale McBride for what it's worth. But one of the young backup corners getting the interception, and Jacksonville gets it back. I think one of the safeties, I think it was Sean Harris, tipped it, and McBride made a nice play on the ball. Jags get it back. Marsusio sacked again, this time by Darius Leonard. The Jaguars' pass blocking this season has been unbelievably good, but today, not so much. I mean, Marsusio Walteron was a sack magnet in college. Third and 11, bad pass. DeForest Buckner's hurt again. But Marsusio Walteron really has not looked good today. He's not been all that accurate. He's missed a lot of throws. And the Colts get it back. It's been a very uneventful third quarter so far. Allen hit as he throws, just has to get rid of it. Nice play by Isaiah Clemmings. And the Colts will have to punt it again. It's been tough sledding for both offenses since the halftime break. Kind of sad when the Colts' starting offense does nothing against the Jags' backups. There's a nice throw by Marsusio over to DJ Chark. Chark is really the only playmaker on this offense who's done much of anything today. Third down, back to Chark inside the 20. As you can see, the Jaguars have still kept their starters on offense out, which is certainly a somewhat bold strategy, but I think they want to make sure the offense is still good because really the past 10-15 minutes, the offense has not been good. Dak McKinley with another sack, his second of the game. That'll do it for the third quarter. That was a really ugly quarter of football. The Jaguars' offense was not very good, and the Colts had a strong opportunity to do some damage control, but they did not capitalize, and I think they're in a sticky situation entering the fourth as Marsusio overthrows DJ Chark. That'll bring the field goal unit out. A 40-yard attempt here for Volker Guntz. He sinks it right down the middle, and the Colts are now down by 20. They need a miracle to keep their playoff hopes alive, but hey, they're facing off against a team of backups. I guess we've seen crazier. Indianapolis with it from the 22. Third and five, Allen looking to throw it, taking a shot for the end zone. He is intercepted for a fourth time. Sean Harris with his first career interception, and it has just been a disaster of the game for Rodney Allen. I know a lot of people have sour feelings for Rodney Allen on this channel, so for the Rodney Allen Hate Club, congratulations. Jaguars would choose some clock. RJ Ewell gets his second rushing touchdown of the game. He is now up to 9 on the year. And this game is totally out of reach. 34-7. Colts would get a last-second touchdown late in the game with T.Y. Hilton, but it's not going to matter. A strong 34-14 victory here for the Jacksonville Jaguars. They eliminate the Indianapolis Colts out of playoff contention, and the Jacksonville Jaguars will finish season number 5 with a record of 13-3. A really strong season here for our Jaguars. I think we are the favorites, at least in the AFC, to get back to the Super Bowl. Both quarterbacks were very underwhelming. Marsusio Walteron kept throwing the ball to the grass. Rodney Allen kept throwing the ball to the defense. Overall, it was a pretty ugly game. I know we scored 34 points, but I wasn't all that impressed with the offense. Defensively, we were phenomenal. Obviously, 4 interceptions. So we're going to simulate the week as we now get into the postseason. We don't have the game because of a first-round bye. Here is a look at the final standings for both conferences. Obviously, we finished with the best record in the AFC. However, the Bucs and Giants both won 14 games. Tampa Bay does get the one seed. They finished the year on a 12-game win streak. That's a lot. The Bucs are even hotter than us right now. Here's a look at the playoff picture as well, and I also want to do a quick miniature season recap. I figured now would be a better time than ever to look at the final season stats, so we're going to do that right here, starting with the passing. Obviously, the big storyline early in the season was Koko and Wosu getting hurt. Marsusio Walteron stepped in. He did a pretty good job. Once Koko and Wosu came back, he did a really good job as well. And although both of them were really solid, we're not a pass-first team. This team identifies as a run-first team, a tough ground-and-pound squad led by rookie running back Isaiah Sparks, who had an unbelievable season running for nearly 1,400 yards and 14 touchdowns. He made the Pro Bowl, he won Offensive Rookie of the Year, and he won the Best Running Back Award in the AFC. RJ Ewell, the backup running back, also nearly had 1,000 yards. I mean, I wasn't really sure what his role would look like at the start of the year, but Ewell was outstanding. We ran for over 2,900 yards this season, which is one of the greatest rushing seasons in NFL history. And to put things in perspective, the gap between us and the team with the second most rushing yards, the Giants, is very close to the gap between the Giants and the Saints when it comes to rushing yards, and the Saints finished in dead last. That just shows how incredible our run game was. And in the playoffs, especially with certain cold weather atmospheres, you need to know how to run the ball, and we know how to do that better than anybody in the league. DJ Chark and Casey Chalk were both great when healthy. They each missed quite a bit of time, particularly DJ Chark, who missed practically the whole first half of the season and still had over 1,000 yards and 12 touchdowns. Casey Chalk would have very easily gotten 1,000 yards, probably would have gotten north of 1,200 had he not gotten injured back in Week 14 against the Texans. The offensive line was incredible. The run blocking was great. The pass blocking was great. This is the best offensive line in the NFL, I think, without question. Defensively, it was a mixed bag this year. We had a lot of good players, but we couldn't stay consistent. We only had one Pro Bowler on the defense, and it's not who you think. It's actually Miles Jack. which was really a surprise to me. Jack missed a lot of time towards the end of the year. I thought he was good this season. I don't know if he warranted a Pro Bowl. Josh Allen, 12 and a half sacks. He got snubbed from the Pro Bowl. And Zaire Wiggins did not get in. I don't know how that makes sense. He was the best cornerback in the NFL this year. Had 5 picks. Number one receivers were completely shut down by him. I mean, I just don't get how Zaire Wiggins does not make the Pro Bowl. That blows my mind. The special teams were good as well. And let's take a look at the final yearly awards as well to see what the league looks like 5 years down the line. So Patrick Mahomes won MVP. I looked at the stats. It really should have gone to Gardner Minshew. He threw 46 touchdowns. Yeah, Gardner Minshew has done well since he left Jacksonville. Russell Wilson wins NFC Offensive Player of the Year. Defensive Player of the Year goes to Shaq Thompson. Robert Maddison, Offensive Rookie of the Year. Defensive Rookie of the Year goes to former Westlake Hornet Joe Lilly, which is great to see. He was the 3rd overall pick this year and had a great season in Carolina. Speaking of the Panthers, their quarterback Keith Fleming had a great season as well. Here are the AFC awards. Isaiah Sparks finished 9th for Offensive Player of the Year. No one in Defensive Player of the Year, surprisingly. Sparks barely won Offensive Rookie of the Year over Patriots quarterback Seguns Romanovskis. Defensive Rookie of the Year went to Trendon Bailey-Raines over Big Tuna, Richard Rivers Jr., surprisingly. Gardner Minshew wins Best Quarterback. As I said, Isaiah Sparks won Best Running Back. RJ Yule finished in 5th. For Best Receiver, we had Chark in 6th and Casey Shock in 9th. Our very own Bentley Vonder Wallison takes home the Best Offensive Lineman Award, with Orlando Brown and Tristan Wirfs also in the running. Josh Allen finishes 10th for Best Defensive Lineman. And then Zaire Wiggins wins the Best Defensive Back Award, which is very well deserved. But how does he win the Best Defensive Back Award and not make the Pro Bowl? That doesn't really make sense to me, but whatever. Bob Adams finishes in 7th. Again, I thought he was really good the second half of the year, but he probably shouldn't be in the top 10. Volker Gontz finishes 5th for Best Kicker, yet he's the one in the AFC who makes the Pro Bowl. So I don't really get how the Pro Bowl criteria worked, but none of our guys are going to be playing in the Pro Bowl anyway, right? Right? Let's hope so. Anyway, let's simulate forward now. We're going to play the lowest seed who wins. So like if New England were to beat the Bengals, it would be them. If the Raiders win, yada, yada, yada. And as you can see, we are playing against the New England Patriots in the second round of the playoffs. They upset the Bengals, led by a 350-yard and 4 touchdown game from Seguns Romanovskis in his first NFL playoff game. So we will not get a Jaguars-Bengals AFC championship for a 3rd straight season, because the Bengals didn't hold their end of the bargain and they lost to a rookie quarterback who's never played in an NFL playoff game before. The mainstays in the AFC playoffs, the Bengals, Chiefs, and Bills all lost. So New England obviously won, and the Jets are playing the Raiders. In the NFC, the Giants, who won 14 games this year, lost to New Orleans. The Cardinals beat San Francisco, and the Washington football team beat the Minnesota Vikings. So we will see the Bucs play the Saints, and the Cardinals play the Washington football team. So that will conclude today's episode. Hope you guys enjoyed the conclusion of the season. Next time, we're going to be playing against the New England Patriots, led by Seguns Romanovskis, the Latvian Laser, one of the only 3 teams this year who have beaten us. Hope everybody enjoyed. Peace out.